So I want to tell you about this no cloning theorem, which is about a fundamental limitation on what you can do with quantum mechanical systems, which is really quite relevant to quantum key distribution, which again is something that you're going to you know, hear more about later. So the fact that it's not possible to copy quantum states, which is what this no cloning theorem says, is really key to the success of quantum key distribution. Okay. All right, so cloning. So what is cloning about? So cloning, I just mean copying. So if I have a cloning machine, that's some device which, you know, I can put whatever I want into it and it gives me two of them. It's a very nice thing to have. You know, and what I'm going to imagine in order to set this up in a way that's nice for the quantum mechanical description that we're going to talk about later, is that actually it's going to have not just one input, but two inputs. So it's going to have two inputs and two outputs. And you know, what you can imagine is that in one of the inputs, you just put in some standard state. So you just put in some chunk of material. Maybe that's the material your clone is going to be built out of. And in the and then in the first input, you put some device that you would like to clone, like perhaps this sheep. Okay, so I guess this is a clay model of a sheep. I guess we know how to clone live sheep, but that's in a different sense. But okay, so we have a clay model of a sheep, and we would like to have two of them. And so what we would imagine is that we have this cloning machine, which, you know, no matter what you put in this register, you know, it not only knows how to build sheep, but it knows how to build cows and pigs and, you know, anything you might like to clone. And it will make two of them. So in this particular case, if you put in the sheep, you get out two sheep. Okay, so this is what I mean by a cloning machine. And from the point of view of classical physics, there's nothing wrong with the possibility of having such a device. You know, in principle, such a device is possible. So, you know, one way you could build such a device is you could make something which would go in and it would measure the location of, you know, it would just go and very accurately measure the dimensions of this thing. It would scan it, you know, figure out exactly how it looks, and then it would just build another one, right? There's no classical physical principle that rules out the possibility of doing that, because in classical physics you can just completely determine the state of a system. So you just completely determine the state of the sheep, and then you make another sheep. Okay. And now this, you know, while this is possible in principle, maybe it's hard to build such a device in practice. But maybe to put this in terms which are more familiar and where you actually can carry this out is to think about the cloning of digital information, right? So with a classical device, you know, say with a classical computer, imagine we have some digital information and we'd like to clone it. And this is something you probably do all of the time on your computer. You know, you copy files. And you're not surprised that you can do this, right? So you can have some file that you'd like to copy, and then you've got maybe some empty file, and then you run it through the cloning machine, which is the, you know, CP command or something like that, and then the output is two copies of the file. And, you know, you can do this, and here, you know, you really do completely know the state of this thing because it's just some digital information that you have written down. And so it's no surprise that you can go in and make a copy of it. So again, this is a completely legitimate process. You know, not only can you do it, but you probably do it all the time. Okay, good. All right, so now the question is, you know, what happens in the quantum world when we try to clone things? Right, so again, we want to imagine that we have a cloning machine which can take as input some quantum state, and it can produce as output two copies of that quantum state. So, you know, maybe we have an atom, and it's in some quantum state. This is not what atoms actually look like. This is some, you know, picture that I found on Google Images. So we have some atom depicted here by this cartoon, and then we have some other, you know, register that we put in some standard state. And then what we would like is that the output of this cloning machine is, you know, two copies of this quantum state, of this very, you know, quantum state, exactly the same as this one. Okay? All right, so it turns out that doing this is actually impossible. So but first of all, you know, if we just think about, you know, some particle that has some position and momentum, well, we can't go through this process of figuring out exactly what's its position and what's its momentum, and then making another particle with exactly the same position and momentum, because there's this thing that I explained to you, or at least mentioned to you, called the uncertainty principle, which prevents you from simultaneously measuring both the position and the momentum of a particle with arbitrary precision. So you actually can't learn the state of a quantum system arbitrarily well. And that prevents at least that way of trying to build this sort of a cloning machine. You can't go in and measure the positions and momenta of all of the particles involved in the quantum object that you would like to clone. But in fact, not only that way of doing it is impossible, but actually it's just impossible in general to build such a device. So you can prove that it's just impossible to build a quantum cloning machine. Okay, so just to put this in the setting of digital information, if we think about this in the context of quantum mechanics, let's imagine that instead of having some atom which has, you know, maybe a whole bunch of electrons whizzing around it and they have lots of positions and momenta, instead we just have a single quantum bit of information, right? So we have some system which can be in the state 0 or in the state 1 or in any superposition of them because of the superposition principle, and we would like to clone it, right? So what would a quantum cloning machine do? Well, it would be a device which would take as input our unknown quantum state, which has some amplitude alpha for the state 0 and some amplitude beta for the state 1, and then it takes some other input which is just in the standard state, say just the state 0, and then it outputs two copies of this unknown quantum state. So whatever alpha and beta were, we get out two copies of the state with the same alpha and beta. Right? That's what it would mean to build a quantum cloning machine that would clone a qubit. And this is sort of the simplest kind of quantum cloner you could try to hope to build, but in fact, this is also impossible. So it is not possible to build a device that does this. It's not possible, even in principle, in the framework of quantum mechanics. So even digital quantum information cannot be cloned. Okay, so this is what usually goes by the name of the no-cloning theorem. So, and it's not just true for qubits or for atoms, or it's really true for any quantum system. So it's just not the case that any valid quantum operation will take some unknown quantum state and make two copies of it. So something that looks like this, regardless of the kind of space that you think about this state psi coming from, such a device is just not possible. So this is the last kind of thing we're going to do is we're going to at least go quickly through the proof that it's not possible to clone quantum states. Okay. All right, so imagine that we have two different orthogonal states. I mean, if we have an interesting system, it has at least two orthogonal states. A one-dimensional system is extremely uninteresting. So suppose we have two orthogonal quantum states, psi and phi, and we have some device which clones them, right? So this is, a proof by contradiction, right? So we imagine that we have some device which clones these quantum states. And by the definition of cloning, what that means is just if we input psi tensor 0, so I guess you've seen this tensor product before, right? This Kronecker product, yeah. So this just means we have two registers. One of them is in the state psi, and the other one is in the state 0. So what the cloner does is it takes the state psi tensor 0, and it produces the state psi tensor psi. It makes two copies of psi. And similarly, if the input state was phi, it makes two copies of phi. That's just what it means to have a cloner. So U is, if it's a valid quantum mechanical transformation, U is a unitary transformation, although we're actually only going to use the property that it's a linear transformation. Okay, so by linearity, suppose we act with this unitary transformation on the state alpha psi plus beta phi, where alpha and beta are just some complex numbers, right? Because of the superposition principle, this is a valid quantum state for any alpha and beta that we take, subject to this normalization condition. So alpha squared plus beta squared is 1. So by linearity, well, let's evaluate what happens if we try to clone this state. So we have something which clones psi and phi. Suppose we then try to clone a superposition of psi and phi. What will happen? Okay, well, we can work this out. We have all the information that we need in order to work out what this state is because we can just use linearity, right? So because U is a linear transformation, this is the same thing as alpha times U acting on psi tensor 0 plus beta times U acting on phi tensor 0, right? So in other words, U acting on this state, which is a linear combination, is the same thing as the linear combination of U acting on the constituent states. That's what it means for a transformation to be linear. Okay, but now we know what U does on these individual states. It copies them, right? Because it's a cloner, because that's what we set up here. So U acting on psi tensor 0 gives me psi tensor psi, and U acting on phi tensor 0 gives me phi tensor phi. So this is the output of the quantum cloner if we try to clone this superposition of psi and phi. Okay, but there's a problem, right? Because this is not what it should have done, right? Because remember, it's a cloner, right? So what does a cloner do? It takes any quantum state and it produces two copies of that state, right? So if we take this state and we just use, instead of, you know, using these rules and using linearity, we just use the definition of cloning, well, what it should do is it should produce the tensor product of this state with itself. It should produce two copies of this state, right? So that's just this, right? It's just the tensor product of this state with itself. That's what it means to make a clone of that state, okay? But now we can just expand this thing out, and we can just use the, you know, the properties of the tensor product. So, you know, we can use the distributive law, which I guess probably you know holds for the tensor product. And if we just expand things out in that way, you know, it's just like expanding out, you know, it's just like the way multiplication distributes over addition that you're, I guess, familiar with. So then you get this state, right? So then you get a state which has a bunch of amplitudes for psi tensor phi, phi tensor psi, and phi tensor phi. And they're given by these various combinations of alpha and beta. Okay? But now this state is supposed to be the same thing as this state, right? This is what we got by using the definition of cloning, and this is what we got by using linearity and the fact that the cloner clones the states psi and phi, right? So these had better be the same states, right? Because this is the same as this. So this has got to equal this. Okay, but that means that, well, you know, psi and phi were actually orthogonal quantum states. We assumed that they were two orthogonal states. And so actually that means that, well, the coefficient of psi tensor psi has to match up. So alpha squared has got to be equal to alpha. And beta squared has to be equal to beta, because the coefficient of phi tensor phi has to match up. And I guess 2 alpha beta has to be equal to 0. So alpha times beta has to be equal to 0. Right? So this is only going to work if we take linear combinations that satisfy these conditions. Right? But how can we satisfy these conditions? Well, I mean, either alpha or beta has to be equal to 0. Right? In particular, to satisfy this condition, we either have to have alpha 0 or beta 0, because if we multiply together two non-zero things, you know, we get something which is non-zero. So either alpha is 0 or beta is 0. Right? So what that means is that actually the only states that we can clone, if we have a state which clones psi and phi, the only linear combinations of psi and phi that we can correctly clone are psi and phi themselves. Right? The only things, you know, if we take any non-trivial superposition of psi and phi, where we have any non-zero amount of both of them, then actually the cloner will not do the right thing. So this shows that the no cloning theorem holds, right? So if you take some cloner which works on two orthogonal states, then it necessarily fails on some non-trivial linear combination of those two states. And this is really the reason why you can't clone quantum information.